We're so glad you're here to listen to this week's sermon from Park Street Church. Park Street is a historic congregation located in the heart of Boston. But more than that, we're a community of people from all different backgrounds who believe and are united by the good news that Jesus is Lord. If you're asking questions about God, your faith, or the meaning and purpose of life, we would love to connect with you. Visit us at parkstreet.org to learn about our community. We hope this sermon encourages you today.
Today is the day of Pentecost, and we are going to look at the account of the Spirit being given to the church in Acts chapter 2. So I invite you to open up the Bible to Acts chapter 2. We'll be in verses 1 through 13, and we're going to begin a study, actually, of this chapter for the next month and a half or so, which is a foundational chapter, a chapter I'm sure many of you know well, calling this series The Origin of Christian Witness, because this is how Christian witness begins. Here in Acts chapter 2. And so we'll see something over the next several weeks of today of the power of God being given for this call and the fact that Christian witness is rooted in that power. And then we'll unpack Peter's sermon for a few weeks and learn more about the shape of this witness. And then we'll take a look in the last couple of weeks at the fruit of gospel witness, both in terms of the immediate response of those who heard Peter, and then also, as many of you know, the text at the end of this chapter, which points to the community, the new people of God, as 3,000 were added to their number that day. It's really the foundation of the church, which is the fruit of Christian witness. So that's the plan over the next many weeks. This passage remains not only foundational for our biblical theology and understanding of the church and the Spirit, but also for each of our lives as well as the people of God. Because even though it's 2,000 years later, even though the context has changed and the world has changed, we are still the people of God, called by God, rescued by God, and sent by God into this world. And our call and our witness, which is a call to be witnesses, doesn't change and hasn't changed for the last 2,000 years. So my hope is that as we study this text together, we'll be reminded of this call to be witnesses, and that this reminder will give us clarity and encouragement in the days ahead. We'll look at this in three parts. First, we want to take a look at, really at chapter one, at the context within which the Pentecost event takes place. Second, at the event itself and the divine encounter. And then third, at what we can learn about the witness or mission of the people of God from the aftermath, or really the verses 5 through 11 in chapter 2, of when people gather to hear what these Galilean Christians are saying. So first, in the context, let's remember where we are. We're after the resurrection of Jesus, and we've been walking through this in kind of the liturgical seasons as well, but we're after the resurrection of Jesus, and that his resurrection, this powerful act of God, always leads to mission. It's meant to lead to mission, because God wants the world to know about Jesus and about him through his Son. This is God's desire. We remember the words of Jesus in the Great Commission in Matthew 28, also after the resurrection, where he says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you." And then here in verse 8 of Acts chapter 1, we find that same commission somewhat repeated at the end of verse 8, "And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." So, because Jesus rose from the dead, because he has been declared to be the world's true Lord, the only hope for the world, and because of these realities, Jesus is now sending his disciples out to go and tell and reveal to the world that this really is the case, that Jesus is Lord, and there is no life outside of him. We read from Isaiah 44, the Old Testament passage today, which includes both the theme of the giving of the Spirit and the theme of God's people being called to be his witnesses. But that chapter is all about idolatry. It's actually a chapter that mocks idolatry in this way. It says, you know, a man will go down and cut down a tree and cut it in half and use half of the tree to create firewood and build a fire by which he can warm himself and cook his food and feed himself. And with the other half, he'll carve an image and bow down and worship. And in that chapter, God, the God of Israel, says over and over again, I am the Lord, there is no one beside me. It's a chapter about the exclusivity, the uniqueness, that God is the only God and there is no other. And he will not share his glory with idols. And so when he calls his people in Isaiah 44 to be witnesses, he's calling them to bear witness to the fact that he alone is the God who made us and the God who gives us life. And there is no other pathway. Part of our witness is to expose the folly of idolatry. And we know that idol-generating reality in us, we're so prone to bow down before other things. But the witness of God's people is to be a witness that there really is no other life that can be found. You can try all you want, and we try hard, but there is nothing else outside of this God. We are to bear witness to this reality. So you will be my witnesses. That's the call and the context of what happens in Acts 2. For those of us who know the church, though, and for who know ourselves, we have to think when we hear this call, God, is this really how you meant for it to work? We know how we struggle with joy and peace. We know how fickle and forgetful that we can be in our walk of faith. We know that we can so often shed our primary identity as children of God and try to find our identity in our work or our wealth or our family, all things that can be good gifts from God, but which when they take the wrong place in our hearts, they become idolatrous, dangerous. Think about the apostles for a moment. This was the band of brothers that was incredibly fickle and was arguing about who was to be the greatest. They were proud. They were stumbling. They had walked away from Jesus and abandoned him in his hour of need. And they were ordinary and uneducated men, we read about in Acts chapter 4. And we can see them asking, God, are you sure? Like, this is the plan that you're going to bear witness to you through us? Are you sure you haven't really made a mistake? And I don't know if all of you who are Christians here this morning have thought about the fact that this call to bear witness is a call upon your life as well. Perhaps that hasn't even entered our minds this week because we've been just so inundated with the work that we have to do or the to-do lists or the tensions that we feel or the difficulties that we're walking through. And yeah, it actually is true. God does want to do this in us and through us. But when we know ourselves, it leads to this real question. Jesus, in a sense, affirms this sense of, are you sure? In the context still in chapter 1 in verse 4, and while staying with them, he ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait. To wait for the promise of the Father. Or again in verse 8 of chapter 1. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And then you'll be my witnesses. In other words, don't leave. Don't start doing this work right now. You're right. You actually can't do this. You need to wait for what we have to give. You need to wait for what I have to give to you. This promise from the Father. If you go out and do this in your own efforts, it won't be very successful. You will fail, and you'll probably be frustrated and end up quite miserable and exhausted. And many of us keep trying, don't we, to do this mission in our own strength. Last week, Ronnie was preaching here, Ronnie Stevens, and he said, at least in the 11 o'clock, which I was able to listen to, that the Christian life is impossible. And it's true. We cannot live this life of love, which we've been called to live by God, in any of our own resources or with any of our strength. We depend upon God to infuse us with his power and grace that we might live the life that he has called us to live. And we know that deep in our own hearts. We need power from the outside to live this out and to bear witness to what we have been called to do. Perhaps you're here this morning and you're discouraged and in regard to your Christian life. You feel distant or remote, removed, numb, confused. Perhaps just disappointed that after so many years of walking with Jesus, you're still wrestling with the same sins, or sense of inadequacy. To some degree, this is every one of us. We all wrestle in these ways. And what I'd like to say is that's a really good place to be. A sense of need, a sense of desperation, a sense of, God, I can't do this without you. God, my heart thirsts for you, my flesh faints for you as in a dry and weary land where there is no water. God, when I look at myself and my weaknesses and I understand who I am, I desperately need you to intervene. The calling upon our lives to bear witness to Jesus as the church is a calling that is far too much for our own resources. And it's this calling that is the context within which the event of Pentecost takes place. It's the context of a call that is far too great for you or for me or for us collectively, for any of us to fulfill. And so Jesus says, wait. Wait. For John baptized with water, verse 5 of chapter 1, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many, many days from now. Or then again in verse 8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. He wants us to receive power. The Holy Spirit is God's gift, God's lavish generosity in pouring out his person, his presence, and his power upon you and me and the collective body of his people. It's a gift that God gives to stumbling and bumbling disciples like us, enabling us to walk into the fullness of what he has called us to do and to be. Augustine once said, command what you will and give what you command. And in many ways, Pentecost is God giving what is necessary and needed and required for the work that he has set before us. The Holy Spirit is divine empowerment for witness. And we should be encouraged because the God who gives this is the God for whom all things are possible. God is saying, I will give what you need so that you can do what I have commissioned you to do. The Holy Spirit is the required resources. He is God himself coming in the Spirit to enable us to have the ability to bear witness to him. Often we're confused with the aims and the person of the Holy Spirit. Sometimes we associate the Spirit with ecstatic experiences that take us up and down and all around and that we need to be fixated upon. And there are many dimensions to the work and ministry of the Holy Spirit, no doubt, and we could spend weeks and weeks and months dealing with that. But I want to say that the clear arrow of the book of Acts, here in Acts 1 and Acts 2, which cannot and should not be missed in light of all of the other dimensions of this great comforter that God has given to the church, is that the Spirit is given to his people to empower us for witness. That's the clear message of the context within which the Pentecost event takes place. Tom Wright says this, the Holy Spirit and the task of the church, the two walk together hand in hand. We can't talk about them apart, despite what you might think from some excitement in the previous generations about new spiritual experiences. God doesn't give people the Holy Spirit in order to let them enjoy the spiritual equivalent of a day at Disneyland. Of course, if you're downcast and gloomy, the fresh wind of God's Spirit can and often does give you a new perspective on everything, and above all, grants a sense of God's presence and love and comfort and even joy. But the point of the Spirit is to enable those who follow Jesus to take into all the world the news that he is Lord, that he has won the victory over the forces of evil, that a new world has opened up, and that we are to help make that happen. End quote. The Holy Spirit is given to enable us to bear witness. He is power for witness. And this mission then begins first and foremost in a posture of reception, of receptivity. We are receiving that which God gives. And the call to bear witness begins there in an open-handed sense of desperation. God, I need you. God, I wait for you. And there is a sense in which obviously this waiting in Acts 1 is unique and the Spirit is given and the Spirit has been given. We're no longer waiting for the Spirit to be given. But there's also a sense in which we continue to wait upon the Lord to be filled with his strength and encouragement and power as we carry on and forward that mission. And so I just want to ask, before we look at the event itself, Is this your posture in your Christian life today? Are you in a posture of being receptive to what God will pour out upon you afresh and anew, day in and day out? You might remember the words of Jesus, "Ask, and it will be given to you. Seek, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened to you." And in Luke 11, where in the Lucan account of that, he ends by saying, look, if you fathers being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, then how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? Are you in a place of being receptive and open, of dependence upon the Lord? Or are you getting out ahead, trying to run in your own strength, and perhaps feeling dry and weary and discouraged as a result? So now let's think about, that's the context, the actual event itself in verses 1-4. God moves, the Spirit descends, and fills his people. So verse 1 of chapter 2, when the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. I'm going to stop there because I don't want to miss this point, which is, this is a communal reality. We often think about the Spirit and me, Spirit and me. And that's not wrong. Each of us is a temple of the living God, though we together are, in whom the presence of God dwells. But notice when this event, this miraculous supernatural beginning to the mission of God's people takes place. It's when they were all together in one place. There's something powerful about the people of God gathered together. We know from the end of chapter 1 that they were praying, waiting upon the Lord. That's a posture in which God works. And that's why the author of Hebrews says, do not forsake the habit of meeting together, as some have done. We need to come together because there's a power in coming together. And that's what happens here. They were all together in one place, waiting, praying, and God moved. And suddenly, there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. The phenomena that we see here on the day, the original day of Pentecost, is fire and sound like a mighty rushing wind. And these are associated, as we think in the, throughout the Old Covenant, of that we think back to another experience when God intervened and entered in, and God manifested his presence to his people at Mount Sinai. There was sound, it was blasts of trumpets, and there was fire on the top of the mountain. Fire is often a signal or sign of the presence of God. Think about when God reveals himself to Moses in the wilderness at the burning bush. There's fire, the bush is on fire, but it's not burning up. Or about the pillar of fire by which he led the people of God through the wilderness journey. Pillar of smoke by day, pillar of fire by night. The fire that passes through the animal pieces, the smoking fire pot and the flaming torch in Genesis 15 when God is making a covenant with Abraham. These are manifestations of the divine presence coming down among his people in a way that was unmistakable for the people of that day, that Pentecost morning. It was only about 9 o'clock in the morning. And they receive power from on high to bear witness. Verse 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I love 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 20. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of talk, but of power. The Holy Spirit brings power, divine power. The church is a place of power. And the power of the Holy Spirit working in the human heart and in the human community to bring about the life of God in us and through us is the power that we depend upon every day. It's God's power. One thing that I think there has been some confusion over the last 100 years or so in light of the movement of the Pentecostal movement, but one thing I am incredibly grateful for that movement for is a reestablishment of conviction about the fact that God is a God of power and an expectation that God in his power would work in the present day. God does continue to work, and there is a sense in which as we fight against the world, the flesh, and the devil, that we desperately need the power of God in that battle. We cannot do it with our intellect or our strategy. That's just folly. But we must take up this mission to bear witness in the power that God provides. And here at Pentecost, that power comes down upon his people in the presence and person of the Holy Spirit for the first time on all of them. Notice, it's all of them in verse 2. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And they were all filled, verse 4. And verse 3, the divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. There's a sense in which this is all is being emphasized here. All need this power. And I would say about this power, there's an internal dimension, which isn't really featured in our text. But the Holy Spirit is the means by which the third person of the Trinity seals for us the benefits of the gospel, of the redemptive work of Christ, of our union with Christ. These benefits are sealed to us through the person of the Spirit. And we need the Spirit's work to apply the work of salvation and redemption in the heart so that it's not just out there abstract facts and truths, but that these are realities that are inside of us that change our hearts and warm our hearts. That internal work of the Spirit should not be neglected, though it's not featured here in Acts chapter 2, I wanted to mention it. But what is featured here is the external reality of that power, specifically in giving these earliest Christians a supernatural gift of speaking in languages that they could not speak on their own. No Duolingo, no class, no ESL. This was divine power, giving a divine gift for a divine purpose that they experience here. They were filled with the Holy Spirit, verse 4, all of them, and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And just to note, in the subsequent verses in 5 through 13, the reality that they could speak these other languages is mentioned three times. In verse 6, because each of them was hearing, each one was hearing them speak in his own language. Again in verse 8, as they say, each of us in his own native language, we hear them. And then again in verse 11, we hear them telling in our own tongues, they say. That's the outward gifting of the Spirit in this unique moment in the mission of God for the sake of bearing witness to him. So as our last section then, I want to think in verses 5 through 11, just make three observations about this mission that's divinely empowered by the Holy Spirit that we see from some details in the text. First, in verse 7, after we read that each one was bewildered because they were hearing them speak in their own language, they were amazed and astonished, verse 7, saying, "Are not all those who are speaking Galileans?" Galilee wasn't known as the place of prominence or sophistication or education. It was the place of simple folk. This wasn't New York City or Washington, D.C. or L.A. or Boston. This was somewhere in a rural place, kind of the backwoods is the way that this was being thought, and this is why they were asking this question. And yet all those who were gathered here in Jerusalem see them doing something that is extraordinary, beyond their natural ability, and they're amazed, and they're astonished. Here's the point, and it comes out of 1 Corinthians 1. We looked at this text last fall, but I want to read these three verses, 27 to 29. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things and the things that are not to nullify the things that are so that no one may boast before him. God was at work in God's upside down way on the day of Pentecost by enabling these Galilean people that were being looked down upon by those in Jerusalem to do something extraordinary and supernatural as his instruments in his gospel mission. Which means if you feel this morning that you are left out of the mechanisms of significance and power and meaning and purpose, you feel like somehow things have missed you, you're in a great place. God loves to use people that by the world's standards don't have much to offer in order to manifest his glory and brilliance and power. And when we think that we are those people that have something to offer, we become far less useful for his mission. So the first point, just notice, it's We need to see that this event of speaking in other languages is coming from the lowly, from Galileans, to demonstrate the brilliance of God's power. A second point is see how this is global in nature. Notice in verse 5, now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And we say, Luke, are you sure? This sounds like Luke in hyperbole. And it is a bit, but it's symbolic, because when you look at the list of nations in verses 9, 10, and 11, they're drawn from all four corners around Jerusalem, as if it's to say, this is from the four corners of the earth. This was the second of three annual festivals, the Feast of Weeks, that began on Pentecost 50 days after the festival of the Feast of Passover. And therefore, Jewish believers from the diaspora would have come to Jerusalem in obedience to God's word to celebrate and give thanks for the ingathering, the first fruits of the harvest, at the end of the barley harvest, beginning of the wheat harvest. And so Jerusalem would have been filled with people from all over the known world or Asia Minor. And Luke is saying, this is symbolic and significant that you have Jews, they're all Jews by Luke's account here, that the Gentile mission had not yet begun. That will happen in chapter 10. But all of these Jews from across the known world have gathered, and each one is hearing these Galileans speak in their own language. God's mission is global. And this fits, doesn't it, with the Great Commission, go into all nations, with what Jesus said in verse 8 of chapter 1, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, and to all the ends of the earth. Well, Jerusalem at that time, kind of like Boston today, was a place where the nations had come. And each one was hearing these people speak in their own language. God is empowering a witness that will go to the ends of the earth. It is universal and global in its reach. And there is no one in the world, no race, no ethnicity, no matter what they have done or not done, there is no one in the world who is beyond the reach of the witness of God's saving power in Jesus. It is global, of the life and salvation and forgiveness that's available in his name. And while I say it is global, I also want to say that global nature of that mission begins with your neighbor and mine. Begins with the people that God has put around us and around us as a church community. The residents of the city of Boston and the neighboring communities that many of you come from. That global reach begins there. And it expands, and this church has had such an amazing history of being a part of that global reach in supporting missionaries who serve Christ in challenging places around the globe. And I praise God for that. The third observation and final one, verse 11. We hear them telling in our own tongues what? The mighty works of God. The mighty works of God. One commentator writes, the community is filled with the Spirit to express the wonders of God in intelligible and intelligent tongues. The wonders of God, the mighty works of God. What is it that the Spirit empowers us to do? It is to point to Jesus. It is to point to the mighty works of God in the life, death, resurrection, ascension of Jesus, through whom the world is being reconciled to God. It is not about self-promotion. I love 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 5, for what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. We are lowly servants pointing to a great king, and that's what we're called to do. We are lowly servants pointing to a powerful God who is mighty to save and to transform our lives and the lives of those to whom we proclaim his gospel. And this includes the intelligent expounding of Scripture, as we'll see as we look at Peter's sermon beginning next week. We are to reject and to forsake the culture of self-promotion with which we are saturated, and to partake of a kingdom culture of Christ exaltation by the power of the Holy Spirit for the sake of the world. So as we think about the mission of God and the day of Pentecost, which are deeply connected, God's power for witness, I want you to hear as we close that God is not so much interested in your resources, though the world around you is. God is not so much interested in your social networks, though you may be and others around you may be. God is not really interested in how many medals you may have on your wall or plaques hanging on your wall, though others might be. God has everything that you need, and he's given you his Spirit to work through you for his glory, honor, and praise. May we not quench the Spirit or grieve the Spirit, but may we, with receptivity and open-handedness and dependence and desperation, wait upon day by day, hour by hour, conversation by conversation, conflict by conflict, wait upon his Spirit, whom he is eager to continue to pour out upon his people, so that he might be glorified and exalted, that Jesus would be lifted up, that the nations would come to know him and join us in his worship. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon your church long ago. And genuinely, we cry out again to you this morning that you would pour your Spirit out afresh upon Park Street Church, upon each of our lives, upon our families, Lord, that we might bear witness to Jesus, to your mighty works, works that are so mighty that they can change a life, a community, and a world. And they have been doing so for 2,000 years. We thank you for the gift of your Spirit on this day of Pentecost. In Jesus' name, amen.